the Financial Sense Tuesday edition with Jim Puplava. Featuring experts on the economy and investing and looking at the bigger picture.
And Chris Martenson joins us next on the program from chrismartenson.com and also the author of an upcoming book called The Crash Course. Chris, I wrote about peak oil actually 10 years ago this month, and we've been doing peak oil on this program for a decade now. And I got a sort of a nasty email from a listener. And the guy said he had been listening to the program for 5 years, and he said, you know what, you're really stuck on this peak oil thing. Why don't you move on to something else and cover something different? And he goes, besides, we still have oil. So I decided to engage in this guy for whatever reason. So we went back and forth with emails, Chris. And to make a long story short, his concept of peak oil was something he could trade and make money on in the markets. And I was saying, no, this is about to change your life in unmeasurable ways that you can't even think of today. And I said, just to make sure that you understand peak oil, let me ask you a couple of questions. What kind of car do you drive? Well, he drives a big BMW. I go, how much time do you spend driving to and from work each day? And he says, well, it's not the distance, it's the traffic jams. He lives in LA. I asked him, have you done anything in your house? For example, what if the refineries in Long Beach shut down and you couldn't get fuel? Where would you be? Have you done anything in your house to equip for emergency, like another Northridge earthquake, where food and water and things like that? So to make a long story, he had done none of those things. His whole idea for peak oil was, well, this is just something that, you know, in a business cycle can drive the price up and I can make some money on. And they don't get it.
Now, do you think this gentleman is indicative of many more people?
Oh, yeah. I mean, you'll have, yeah, I get the peak oil story. You know, I've got oil stocks. Okay. No, oil stocks, you know, you might make some money in them, but, you know, how's your life going to be affected? That's the part they don't get.
Yeah. Well, it's an entire change of a paradigm, and I don't use that word lightly. I think it gets overused from time to time, but this truly means that the way I look at it, we're facing something that humanity has never faced before, which is slightly less energy next year than this year. And that's never been true before. And around that model of always slightly more energy available to us, we've constructed an entire energy-intensive system of economic model, we could call it, but to break the economy down, goods, services, things that move from point A to point B, global networks, supply chains, highly cost-efficient structures, but not terribly robust. And we literally have no idea how those interrelated structures are going to behave when they get slightly starved for energy. But one thing we can be pretty confident of is, you know, nature gives us lots of models of complex systems. When you starve any complex organism for energy, it gets simpler, and often not in a good way. So my body's a complex system. Starve it for energy, that's food, and it'll be much more prone to illness, sickness, even collapse. And so we can easily predict that taking an economic model that has no resiliency, no redundancy, no awareness, planning for the imminent onset of slightly less energy, and we can predict it's going to go through some pretty rough patches. To me, that's a very defendable position. It's at least solidly grounded enough that everybody deserves to, ought to, take a good look at it. And maybe they can reject it after that, but I think to just sort of look at this whole thing and say, you know, peak oil, it's a slight change, I'll buy a few stocks, is missing the picture. And worse, I know people who fall into, I think it's a mental trap where they say, you know, I'm convinced that somebody is just holding oil back from us to make more money off of it.
Yeah, you get into sort of these conspiracy things, and you've seen it. Heck, our politicians grandstand with it. Anytime that you see, for example, remember when oil prices spiked from Katrina and Rita and we went from 50 to 70? Well, what did Congress do? They had a investigation, they dragged the CEOs of the oil companies, never mind that they only produce about 15% of the world's energy. They dragged them before Congress, and they did the same thing in the summer of 2008 when we had $147 oil. And what nobody has asked, and this is the thing that just, I don't care if you're reading the IEA, the EIA, SARA reports, why is it with a sevenfold increase in the price of oil this decade, that worldwide oil production has been flat since 2005. I mean, if you could get triple digits as light sweet crude is selling and Brent is selling right now, why wouldn't you produce as much as you can? And the other thing, Chris, that always surprises me is every year the BP statistical review comes out. OPEC produces 40% of the world's energy and their reserves never change. They haven't changed in 20 something years.
Yeah, there's another mystery in that data series too, which is that if we look at the crude and condensate, the C plus C that Saudi Arabia has been producing, 2002, they produced 7.1 million barrels a day. And in 2002, the global average price of oil was $26 a barrel. Now, you ramp that forward, and by 2005, they were up to 9.1 million barrels a day, being the swing producer. Oil is $57 a barrel. So this makes sense, right? They've increased production by 2 million barrels a day. It's over a four-year period because the price of oil is more than doubled. But now let's fast forward from 2005 to today. Let's call it, you know, I have data for 2010. Average world oil price was $79 in 2010. And despite that, despite the fact that oil had gone from $57 to $79, Saudi Arabia produced 7.1 million barrels a day, down 22% from its high. That is really strange behavior for a country that has historically had a very tight alignment between how much it pumped and oil prices. It's something that is puzzling enough that it really should give you pause. We should look at it and say, that is really strange behavior. What could explain this? And, you know, there's not that many great explanations I can come to that make sense from a market standpoint, but there are several that I can come to that make some good sense, I think, from a geologic standpoint or a reality-based standpoint, which says either they don't have it to pump, they're having difficulties pumping, their water cuts are going up, something is happening to create actual production difficulties, or they've decided to hold it back because they would rather have it in the ground than the money today, which is a possibility.
Yeah, the other thing, too, is I find it amazing. When you look at, I don't care if you look at the IEA's work, the EIA's work, and, Chris, you've seen the charts. They'll have, for example, conventional oil. It's in decline. Then they'll have new projects that are coming online that will be the next color graph, but it's still in decline. You've got the alternatives. And then I call it the plug number. And the plug number is this is where demand's going to be 5, 10, 20 years from now. And have you noticed over the last 3 or 4 years that plug number just keeps getting bigger and bigger? And I guess a question that people do not really understand, if we have not been able to replace or find new oil to replace what we consume each year for several decades, what makes all these experts and these people believe that we're going to do it in the next couple of decades?
Well, Jim, I haven't seen any discoveries that have come out that are going to be able to make up the shortfalls that we know about, that we're experiencing, that are very easy to catalog, that are very well publicized. Declines in the North Sea, for example, people have probably read about those. Those are fairly famous and legendary at this point. The Cantarell collapse in Mexico, the declines in every country that has been producing for, you know, a good long number of decades has entered decline. And so at this point, you know, the data is really overwhelming that, first of all, oil is a finite substance. Second of all, you have to find it before you can pump it. Third of all, the faster you pump it, the faster it runs out. So many of these new technologies, which are incredible, I applaud the engineering involved, but many of them, the slant drilling, the bottle brush drilling, all of those things, they just allow us to get it out faster. But sometimes they don't really improve how much we can get out. You know, the toothpaste just comes out of the tube faster. There's no more toothpaste in the tube than there used to be. And when we look through those sorts of petrol realities, everything that I've seen so far is absolutely in support of the idea that we are right at pretty close to global total all liquids production at this point in time, give or take a couple of years. But the IEA has already said flat out in the rearview mirror, conventional oil, cheap and easy, that's in the rearview mirror. They said 2006. My data says 2005. Let's split the difference. We're somewhere in there, right? This is very serious business because as far as I can tell, we have not yet really begun in any meaningful way to adjust to that reality in this country. So think about the adjustments we're going to have to go to if we want to manage that transition gracefully. And, you know, we just had some incredible warning signs. I don't know if you saw in the news, but got a little cold in the Southwest.
Oh, yeah, Texas and New Mexico.
Sure, and it kind of overburdened the system, and they had to do rolling blackouts, which ended up causing gas line pressures to drop, which ended up shutting down gas turbines, which meant that New Mexico suddenly had a crisis of gas pressures. all kinds of things happened in this complicated system again, and there was just a little stress put on it, and it sort of failed in some interesting ways. You know, that to me is a perfect metaphor for the challenges we're going to face, because I hear people say this to me all the time. Oh, but we've got 100 years of natural gas. Well, look, we couldn't even handle natural gas in one region of the country when it got a little cold out. What happens when we start plugging 100 million cars into that network? So guess what? We could fix that, but we have a huge infrastructure build-out that has to go on. We have to retrofit all kinds of stations, our pipelines, our storage facilities. We have to retrofit existing cars, build new ones. All of that would have to happen, and it hasn't yet. I don't see signs of it yet.
You know, it's amazing because in my own state of California, you know, we're supposed to be the green state, but we have wind in one of the longest offshore coastlines of any state in the country. We have sun in the desert, and we have a lot of oil offshore, and we have over 10% of the country's population. You can't put up wind offshore. You can't put up solar in the desert. You certainly can't drill for oil, and we're not building any power plants. And it's indicative of what we've seen across the country, as you just mentioned. You get a cold spell in New Mexico and all of a sudden Texas, and all of a sudden they've got rolling brownouts. They've got problems on the East Coast. Heating oil has gone through the roof with all these storms. And the thing about all of this, and I guess this is something that I want to get to, is you've been talking about peak oil. I've been talking about peak oil. And people, as this emailer and listener to the show, thought, oh, this is just something that I trade and I can make some money in oil stocks. And Chris, I'm preparing for it because I think we're heading into the crisis window. We're starting construction on our house. I have 6 months worth of food supplies. I am working with getting bids where we have a solar system that's completely off the grid system because we get rolling blackouts. What good is solar if the local utility turns you off? We have food. We're going to have the ability to grow food. I traded in my gas guzzler for a hybrid. I've got a second hybrid and electric car, so I have my own electric source. I mean, this is reality. And on top of that, I've arranged my life that I could walk to work in 30 minutes. I could probably bike to work in 15, and I can get to work in my car in 10. So if I had to, if we went to rationing, if I had a Prius with a 10-gallon tank, that would last me 3 months getting to and from back to work. So at least we're taking this serious. I wonder if you might want to talk about what you've been telling your viewers that come to your website and some of the videos and also your new book that's coming out that, you know, no, this isn't something you just trade around. This is something that's going to change your life or if you own a business in ways you never even thought possible.
You're absolutely on, I think, a very prudent course, and it's one that I'm on as well. And guess what? Tens, if not hundreds of thousands of other people are on the same path. And I think we've all, the people who are taking these sorts of preparations, we've all sort of come to the collective decision that by the time our government gets around to determining that there's some sort of a crisis, and by the time you can read about it above the fold on the front page of your major newspapers, it'll be too late to really make any substantive changes. That the best time to get in on any investment or to make any major changes is before the herd. And in this story, the more time you can give yourself, that's the better, because that's your most important asset. Those sorts of things you've been talking about that you've done, I'm going to guess, they're going to take you years to complete, right? From the time you decided that this is something you needed to do till, you know, when you would say, I've got this completed, getting solar systems up. And all those steps, they take time. So if today 1% of the households in this country said, that's it, I need to have solar hot water panels on my roof because I consider hot water to be a non-negotiable luxury of human existence. We don't even remotely have the capacity, manufacturing capacity and installation capacity to deal with that sort of demand. Welcome to the back end of a 2-year waiting line if you happen to get late to that story. So these sorts of preparations are absolutely prudent things to do because we have to control the risks ourselves as much as we can, because unfortunately there are no signs yet that we're getting this as a narrative at the national level. And we'll get there, but trust me, you know, after watching how the government responded to Katrina, I realized, yes, they finally responded and got stuff done, but it was not optimal. It was very much more chaotic than it needed to be, and there were some real powerful lessons in that for people who are paying attention to that. To the point of, you know, can we just sort of trade our way around?